Welcome. My name is Matt Davis. No, I might not be George Clooney, and I might not be Brad Pitt, but I could be someday. And the possibilities are endless for my future and the future of Sidney High students. Tonight, I invite you to meet some of Sidney High's own local celebrities. Upon this wall are some of many local celebrities that have been honored previously. Tonight, we will be honoring four more local celebrities. Let me give you a glimpse into tonight's ceremonies.
Words fall short in describing our first Hall of Honor inductees. They are both two stars that have shone bright in so many lives. Jim and Doris Abbott, both 1962 Sidney High graduates, are being recognized for their ongoing act of humanitarianism. These two remarkable individuals have parented 90 children, 3 natural, 6 adopted, and 81 as foster children. The Abbotts helped raise so many children that they had to be licensed by the state of Ohio as a group home. When Jim was approached in the fall of 2004 as a nominee for the Hall of Honor, he wished instead to give the credit and honor to his wife Doris, saying, "She did much of the work while I was earning a living. They both will be honored this year for their beautiful gifts they've given to all their children." Sadly, Doris passed away 3 years ago, leaving Jim to carry on their legacy. He continues to be a compassionate and loving father to all their children. Doris is a star that continues to shine brightly over us all, while Jim continues the work that they started together. His star shines among us. I'm sure that many of you have seen the hit movie Pearl Harbor, but how much do you know about the heroes that served our country during World War II? One such hero is William H. Deam, a Hall of Honor inductee and 1940 Sidney High graduate. During his 3-year-long career in the Army Air Corps, William Deam flew a total of 63 missions over France and was decorated multiple times. Following his service in the war, Bill Deam returned to Sidney, his hometown, to marry and start a family, and work for both his family and community. Though his job took him out of the town in the late 50s, the 60s marked Bill Deam's return to the fabulous Sidney, Ohio. William Deam has a long history of public service. He spent a quarter of a century on Sidney's Zoning Board of Appeals and served as chairman for 15 years. Though it was a thankless position, it was Bill's way of giving back to the community. He has also been recognized for outstanding service to both the IUDIS Club and Rotary International. I object. Some members of the community have objected the fact that Mr. Harry N. Faulkner had not, until now, been elected in the Hall of Honor. The reason that Mr. Faulkner, a prominent lawyer in the Sidney area and 1959 graduate, was not elected until this year is that he had been a member of the selection committee. In addition to serving on this committee, Harry Faulkner is a partner of one of Sidney's largest and most successful law firms. He founded the Western Ohio Development Council in 1983. Around that time, he also helped to bring government and business leaders together in hopes of counteracting the high unemployment rate. He met with success when Honda came to the area in 1984. Harry has helped to bring numerous additional businesses to the area since then, and remains the chairman of WODC. He now resides in Sidney with his wife Bonnie, and has 3 grown children, and continues to practice law and serve the community. Have you ever wanted to change something about Sidney High School? While we at SHS oftentimes circulate petitions and ask for changes to be enacted, those with the greatest impact are men like Larry Lorton. Larry Lorton graduated from Sidney High School with the class of 1956, and would later be responsible for many educational reforms. He earned degrees from Miami and Akron, and landed his first job teaching math and coaching football. His math skills later came into play when he tackled budgeting, purchasing, and retirement issues. He also addressed the controversial issue of desegregation and worked toward equal opportunities for women and minorities. Recently, Larry Lorton testified before Congress as the No Child Left Behind legislation was formulated. Though Larry Lorton resides in Arnold, Maryland, his impact on the educational system has been so great that he has earned his spot among the 80 other Hall of Honor inductees, which will be proudly displayed on the walls of the alma mater, Sidney High School.
You have just witnessed some of the great achievements of our four local celebrities. In years to come, you could find your plaque on this wall. Take my hand and join me tonight in an experience that will move and inspire you. The Hall of Honor begins at 7:30 p.m. in the Sidney High School Auditorium.
That video was produced by a relatively new class here at Sidney High School, television production, under the direction of Amy Gleason. This video was shown to high school students this morning. For the second straight year, we've opened our induction with this in-house SHS production to more closely link the student body to the Hall of Honor and the alumni of Sidney High School and the Sidney City Schools. This class has also undertaken video duties for the ceremony itself, once again with the goal of uniting students with this event. Amy, to you, Tech Supervisor Robert Allen, and your students, thanks and congratulations on a job well done. Your class and its work are now fixtures at the Hall of Honor. That's a great way to start our evening. I'm Dave Ross, now in my second year as chairman of the Sidney City Schools Hall of Honor, which represents the highest honor bestowed by the Sidney City Schools. While most of our members, including all of tonight's class, are Sidney High School graduates, some others have come from the outside to profoundly and positively impact our schools as employees and/or supporters. Now remember this. And I will use the words of that great Shelby County and Sidney philosopher, Harry Faulkner. This is not a Puritan church service. This tonight is a celebration. Feel free to laugh, applaud. If a tear comes to your eye, don't worry about it, as long as it's honest and appropriate. Enjoy your evening as you help salute the induction class of 2006. We're glad you're here, and we hope you'll return on Friday, May 18th, 2007, and beyond. Tonight's program continues with new Superintendent of Schools Mike Trigo, himself a former Sidney band director. He's been here before. We're glad to have him back. Mike brings energy and enthusiasm to the Sidney City Schools. Mike will offer his comments, then lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Welcome home, Mike Trigo.
Thank you. Good evening, and on behalf of the Sidney City Schools, the Board of Education, the administration, the staff, and most importantly, the students, I welcome you tonight. I told my father, Dad, my dad's about 80. I'm going to go make a speech. And he said, remember, be brief, be sincere, and be seated. So I will honor my father tonight also. It is my honor and sincere pleasure to be here tonight to celebrate accomplishment, tradition, heritage, community, and family. The accomplishment of our inductees, the tradition of excellence of the Sidney City Schools, the heritage of pride, the community of learners, and the family relationships that we share with each other. Since returning to Sidney this past January, I found many reasons to stand tall and be proud of our schools, our students, and our staff. And one of the most proudest reasons is this Hall of Honor. Hall of Honor is one of the most impressive pride-instilling traditions that the Sidney City School District has. And I always tease Lou Blackford when I see him. Lou used to be my principal when I taught at the middle school. And you did something right, Lou. I know you're out there somewhere. So I thank you for that. And I thank every one of you for being here tonight to be a part of that. I think that's very unique, and I think it's very special. So whether you're a past or present inductee honoring us tonight with your presence, a nominator bringing forth a deserving candidate, a relative or a friend offering deserving support and praise, a Board of Education member whose purpose is to service our youth, a staff member or student inspired to greater achievement, or a parent or a community member enthused about tonight's accomplishment and those to come in the future. Whatever your involvement tonight, it is appreciated and it is essential to the success of our students. I want to personally thank tonight all of our inductees and all of our past honorees who are on the wall out there for being outstanding role models for our youth. I think that's special and I think that's unique. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, would you please stand with me and honor our country by saying with me the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Again, thank you, and let's enjoy the celebration tonight.
Thank you, Mike. Tonight's invocation will be both special and appropriate. Three of our four inductees worship at Sidney's First United Methodist Church, which is very well represented tonight, not only on stage, but also in the audience. I now present the Reverend Dan Gildner, Pastor of Youth and Life Development.
Join me in prayer this evening. Lord, thank you for legacies. I thank you for, as you wrote in Hebrews, about those that came before us that left things behind for us not just to see and even look at on our way into a hallway, but they left traits behind that we want to emulate. And Lord, I know both the men and the women that are represented on that wall and up on stage here, they probably wouldn't consider themselves superheroes or even celebrities. They're just men and women that made right decisions. And Lord, they made decisions of love, made decisions of sacrifice. They made decisions for the sake of others. And Lord, for that we recognize them and we celebrate them tonight. Thank you that you don't leave us without witnesses, that you don't leave us without men and women to pattern our lives after. Lord, we know that you're delighting in them tonight, and so Lord, we want to do the same. May you be pleased with this celebration, now and always. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Dan. Next to join us, student representation, the president of the Sidney High School student government, Katie Bowler. She's a multi-talented senior honor student who also takes pride in many cheerleading accomplishments over the last 4 years while rooting for our Yellow Jackets. She's headed to Columbus, she knows that much, for either Capital University or The Ohio State University. The major will be in either fashion merchandising or English education. Representing the students of both the high school and the entire school district, a very able and capable representative, please welcome Katie Bowler.
Good evening. My name is Katie Bowler, and I currently serve as president of the Sidney High School student government. On behalf of the students of the Sidney City Schools, it is with great pleasure I join you tonight in honoring our deserving leaders. As young people, guidance and direction are a true necessity in the development of our character. Ralph Waldo Emerson once said, "Do not go where the path may lead. Go instead where there is no path and leave a trail." These honorees have not only contributed to the prosperity of our school system, but have also paved the way for the continued growth and success of Sidney and the surrounding community. We are very fortunate to commend the achievements of an honorable veteran and business leader, two extraordinarily selfless caregivers, an accomplished attorney and community leader, and an outstanding educator and administrator. The dedication of these alumni has set forth an example which we can all truly benefit from. Their tireless commitment and dedication to the betterment of the community is something to be eternally grateful for. Through their servitude and generous contributions, these leaders have rightly earned inductions into the prestigious Hall of Honor. Thank you, Class of 2006 inductees, for your continued support of our schools and community. Your hearts for others and admirable leadership is truly a gift that will not soon be forgotten. Thank you.
And Katie, best wishes to you and your class of 2006. Ever since I can remember, Sidney High School, many times in this same auditorium, has enjoyed a very strong tradition in its vocal music classes and groups. That continues in the current school year under the direction of Amanda Hughes, who came here to Campbell Road at Sidney High School last fall. Tonight, our special music will be provided under her direction by the Sidney High School Chamber Choir.
Benedictus, Benedictus, qui veni.
Thank you, Miss Hughes and the chamber choir. I have to confess something. One, I am not Dave Ross. He should be up here. The other thing is that I'd send out a bundle of materials to the staff today, as I usually do on Fridays, to kind of get them through the weekend, and I sent so much I crashed our internet site this morning. They were still working on it, so in my haste to get ready for tonight and from our pregame warm-up, I was amiss at not introducing any of our board members who are here tonight. And since I can't see, since the lights are so bright, thank you. Any of our board members, if you are here, would you please stand so I could recognize you? Anybody? Dan Ernst is in the back, our board vice president. Up front is Robert Bowler, one of our board members. Thank you for attending. Okay, thank you. Thanks, Dave.
The choir, or a segment thereof, will rejoin us later to lead the recessional singing of the alma mater. We also at this time wish to thank Andrea Keller for providing tonight's piano accompaniment. Nice job on all fronts, folks, with the music. And may we again have the lights up. Before we present our first inductee of 2006, let us reflect back on the first 76 inductees into the Sidney City Schools Hall of Honor. As I name all 76, those present should stand and remain standing until all 12 previous induction classes have been acknowledged. Please hold your applause until I complete the Z's of 2005. And there were two of them, Zielsdorf and Zimpfer. We begin in 1994 with 10 inductees. J. Oliver Amos, Mary Agnes Brandaway, Rebecca Krim, Bob Hipple, Lois Lenski, William Milligan, Granville Robinson, William Ross Jr., Dean Atlee Snyder, Colonel Pete Steffen. The class of 95 had 7 members: Ruth Bennett Emmons, Ida Haslip Good, Paul Lauterbur, Ph.D., future winner of the Nobel Prize, Lieutenant Colonel Lloyd Lutz, Colonel Ralph Monroe, Marcia Shattuck, M.D., and L. Jack Van Fossen. Class of 96, Linda McReynolds Bryant, Russell Bunker, deceased since our last induction, Richard Flanagan, William Hudson Jr., Harold C. McDermott, William Menchus, M.D., Rear Admiral Roger Spreen, John Herman Enders from the class of 97, which has 6 members. Also Thomas Given, William Jocelyn Sr., James Russell, Donald Thompson, and Dorothy Dull Wells. On to the class of 98, Robert Burns, C. Wayne Davis, Cheryl Edler, who will be up here momentarily, Margaret Margot Russell, Homer Champ Jr., Cecil Watkins. The class of 99, six members, William T. Amos, John Blake, Betty Weaver Fridley, Wilbur Johnston, DDS, Patrick Milligan, and Jenny Zorn. The class of 2000 also had six members, John Harmony, Marianne Lauterbur Helmlinger, James Humphrey, also deceased since our last induction, Thomas Caselius, MD, Steve Lorton, Richard Slegel. Class of 01, six members, Jane Wersner Felgen, Paul Fitzwater, Richard Henke, Benjamin Lefevre, Gary Van Fossen, and the Sidney High School Yellow Jacket football teams of 68, 69, and 70. The class of 2002 included Dr. George Clyde Fisher. Five more members were Dr. Clayton Kirchhoff, James McLean, Roger McGee, Nancy Olson, here tonight from Miami, Florida, and we appreciate Major League Baseball sending her employer to Cincinnati this week, the Florida Marlins. Also, David Schroeder. Class of 03, six members again, Judge Joseph Barnes, Lewis Blackford, Richard Cromer, William Dodd, Sharon Eikenberry, and Dr. William Von Meyer. The class of 2004, Kathleen Guy Boykin, Julia Taylor Lamb, Sergeant James Locker, Bruce Moon, PhD, and Donald Steffen. The class of 2005, William Coville, the man who donated all of this land out here, Rob Potorf, Sheila Sly Robinson, Robert Zielsdorf, and Fletcher Zimpfer II, MD. We also appreciate the relatives of deceased Hall of Honor members who join us annually to represent these prior inductees. These are the folks who came before. There are 76 of them. Tonight we had four more for a total of 80. Well, it's time to get rolling. Our order tonight will be alphabetical, and we start with the name that almost always gets to go first under that format. James and Doris Davis Abbott will be presented by a 1998 Hall of Honor inductee. He's a former Hall of Honor committee member and currently serves as the personal advisor to the Hall of Honor chairman. And as we bring him forward, we've got a special milestone to acknowledge this man. This school year marks the 50th anniversary of his first employment and involvement with the Sidney City Schools. Would you please welcome to introduce the Abbotts, Cheryl Edler.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my great honor and privilege to introduce to you Jim Abbott, who will accept his and his wife Doris Abbott's membership into the Sidney City Schools Hall of Honor class of 2006. I've known Jim and Doris for nearly 50 years as their teacher, their colleague, and their friend. But let me be to tell you that Jim, while he calls me a mentor, I have learned far more from him and from Doris than they ever learned from me. 44 years ago, on a raised platform in the Sidney High School gymnasium, a short walk from here, Jim Abbott and Doris Davis were crowned king and queen of the 1962 junior-senior prom. That honor was an event that I think symbolically marked them for the rest of their lives. Jim is a metaphor of their lives together. He never quit. He never gave up. He always accepted a challenge. When I asked him for a two-minute monologue in Spanish, he gave me 20 minutes, and I had to ask him to sit down or he would have taken the entire period. He was always eager to do more than he was asked to do. He was always an athlete. He played varsity soccer for Miami University during his last 2 years at the school. He chose what was, at that time, not an especially popular sport at the university. Jim and Doris were married shortly after they received their bachelor's degrees in education at Miami. They moved to Sydney and began their careers in teaching and in raising the family. The couple throughout their lives always worked with children. Doris taught elementary children. Jim was a secondary school classroom teacher, a coach, a guidance counselor, assistant principal, a superintendent of schools. Early in their lives together, they recognized the need to help children with special needs, not those who had minor problems than those who had fallen through the social cracks. They chose to help those who were discarded and forgotten. They followed the principle in the New Testament book of Luke, of those to whom much has been given, much is expected, a verse they often quoted and a philosophy they always lived. Jim and Doris cared for those who couldn't talk, who couldn't walk, who couldn't feed or bathe themselves. They cared for these children over the years. They loved them as their own. They saw them as children who lived, breathed, had hopes and dreams. Jim and Doris helped bring them joy, happiness, and love. They put the light of hope into the eyes of children like Robbie and Katie, whose total being smiled with the promise of a happy life, while most of us would consider the time, effort, and years spent to meet the special needs of these children as major sacrifices. Jim and Doris recognized them as a challenge necessary to give these children hope. When I asked them, why do you do this? You can help those with special needs, but why spend your lives with children with the most severe physical and psychological problems? The look in their eyes told me that they did not believe they were making any sacrifice at all. One morning as I walked out of McDonald's with a cup of coffee, I saw Doris sitting alone over some papers while she nibbled on her breakfast. I caught her eye, but before I could speak, she said, this is my downtime, a time to relax a little. But spread out before her were papers she was preparing for the classes she would meet at school. Doris passed away a few years ago. In the final days of her life, her thoughts lay as usual outside herself. She was concerned about Jim and the children. Scott, Elizabeth, and Brett, their natural children, joined their parents in their care of the fostered and adopted children who came into their family. And today, Elizabeth continues the tradition. She holds advanced degrees in helping and serving the needs of children with special problems and is presently working with individuals and classes of children with a variety of special needs. One of Jim's favorite books, it was Miguel Cervantes' Don Quixote de la Mancha. Most of us can recall the famous scene from the novel as Don Quixote attacked windmills on the plains. He identified them as giants bent on destruction. Sancho, his sidekick, saw them as windmills, ugly but a natural part of the environment. Jim and Doris were always tilting at windmills. Most of us see the neglect of the unfortunate and forgotten children as ugly facts of life, someone else's problem. Jim and Doris recognized them as a challenge that had to be met. A line from the novel Cervantes, I believe, it captures the essence of their lives. They strove with their last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable stars, and the world was better for this. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. James Abbott.
Thank you for those very kind comments. I also want to thank you and Lois for 45 plus years of friendship, mentoring, support, believing in us from the time that we were here at the high school with you and in your classes and in some free time. Thank you. Also want to thank Bill Heath, another friend and former counselor when we were students here, for putting together our nomination. I would be remiss if I didn't also thank the Children's Services of Shelby County. We worked with them for about 15 years, and in particular, Deb Harshbarger, now Deb Downey, worked to get us kids. We'd sometimes get calls in the middle of the night. We were an emergency and short-term foster placement. An emergency placement might be one day for a couple girls while their mom was getting outpatient treatment at the hospital. We had another weekend, a young man that came on a Saturday afternoon, and they promised he'd be gone Monday morning. That was 23 years ago. He's now my oldest kid. They forgot to come get him. When Deb left Shelby County, she went with another agency called SAFI. And we followed her because she was able to get us access to the kids that Mr. Other was talking about, the kids from the children's hospitals in Columbus and Cleveland and Cincinnati and places like that, Akron, and many points in between. the SAFI organization was extremely helpful, supportive of us, both the caseworkers and the administration, and I want to publicly thank them. Also, I would be remiss if I didn't thank the other people in the schools and outside the schools of this community. You have all heard the expression, it takes a village to raise a child. We had bus drivers who would not know when they pulled up to our house in the morning which kids would be getting on. Tony Wagner down at the swimming pool said, you've got a family pass, and he just instructed his staff, whoever they bring in his family, that's it. We don't know who it's going to be. We got the same sort of reception from the YMCA, tremendous support from them. We had kids in not only the Sidney schools, but in the multi-handicapped classes at Anna and Botkins, the multi-handicapped here, especially at Sidney High School, just did a terrific job. And we couldn't have done it without their support. I also want to thank our parents, Doris's parents and my parents, both for the role models that they provided to us in reaching out and caring for other people. Also for their openness and flexibility when we would show up for a family gathering with extra kids, have to introduce them. But also for countless hours of babysitting, respite care, coming and doing odd jobs around the house. One of the things that Doris and I did to keep ourselves going was that we started a tradition of every evening going out for coffee and a piece of pie or something. And that many times that meant dropping kids off with grandma and grandpa. That was a lifesaver for us, and we greatly appreciate that. I really want to say thanks to our kids. Doris always made the point, we're not a foster parents, we're our foster family. Not only did they share their rooms, sometimes their clothes, their toys, their possessions, they also shared mom and dad's time and attention. We tried to make up, but we know that they did get shortchanged. There were good times. There were times that having foster kids there meant having new friends to share activities with, that sort of thing. I remember a Sunday morning, someone got picked up off the interstate, DUI, had a child with him. What do you do with the child? Dad's getting sober or uncle's getting sober in jail. What do you do with the child? Well, Brett takes him under his wing and he says, here, got some clothes, it'll fit you. You're going to church with us. The kids became expert at making kids feel comfortable and fit in. There were bad times. There were times that having extra kids there meant textbooks or baseball cards or something like that might get vandalized or stolen. Birthday money, Christmas money disappeared. Fights, feuds. I remember one night coming home from work and sitting down at the table and seeing a big, long, angry scratch down Scott's neck. Didn't say anything. A few minutes later, I noticed that John also had identical, matching scratch mark. It was only several days later I overheard Scott reinforcing the rules. You don't bite, kick, or scratch until they do it first. A couple observations I'd like to make. Doris and I never did sit down and say, we're going to have 90 kids and 9 kids and 90 foster kids. What we did decide was that God had given us gifts and talents and expected us to use them. Doris discovered during her first year of teaching that she not only really enjoyed, but she had a real touch, a real knack for working with kids that had special needs, that were different, that learned differently, that needed to have extra or a different type of attention in order to reach their potential. So for over 25 years of teaching kindergarten classes, she cultivated this talent. During the last several years of our foster parenting, we specialized in kids who came with heart monitors or breathing equipment or shaken babies or CP or muscular dystrophy like Robbie or whatever like that. She just ate it up. It was her thing. She retired after 25 years of teaching kindergarten so that she could go to nursing school and get kids with even more severe challenges. That was her gift. My gift was following directions. And we believe that we should use our gifts. Another observation, like I said, we never sat down and made one decision, a plan, we're going to have 90 foster kids. It was a series of decisions. Her women's group at the church was having their annual mother-daughter banquet. That when the children's home was still open, and they decided, well, there's girls at the children's home, instead of just bringing our own daughter, if you don't have a daughter, go to the children's home, pick up one of those, and bring them to the mother-daughter banquet. Well, Doris decided not only to do that, but also to take her shopping. So Saturday afternoon, they went shopping. Ended up, Cindy lived with us for a year. There were decisions all along the line. Do we continue? Do we take a break? Do we start up again? Do we accept this particular challenge? It's a series of decisions. And after Doris had contracted cancer 5 years ago, they came out with a song on the radio that caught her attention, and we played it at her funeral. When you get the choice to sit it out or dance, I hope you'll dance. She had a talent, and she chose to dance. Thank you.
I'm glad the name Abbott's at the head of the alphabet. That is one dandy way to start this evening. It's been my pleasure to serve on the Hall of Honor Committee for a number of years. I've worked alongside some great folks who have taken our task quite seriously. Our current committee consists of 14 members who have graduated from Sidney High School and or have a genuine demonstrated interest in public education within our school district. We each bring a unique perspective to the annual deliberations that produce each new induction class. I'm proud of those I currently serve with, along with those who came before. Would you please bring up the lights, as we would like the current committee members present this evening to please stand as called and remain standing until the entire group can be recognized at the end. Paula Benshoff, Brett Bickle, Sandy Bucker, Lou Blackford, Mark Deam, Dave Foltz, Jim Hall, Greg Johnson, who is acknowledged in tonight's program for his great service, Ken McCormick, Tom Milligan, Jeff Sargent, Betsy Tramontana, Mike Trigo, and a new member who will join next fall, Duane Mullen. Thank you for your service. My parents graduated from Sidney High School in 1940. If they were here, they would be elated that one of their classmates is our next inductee. Bill Deam will be introduced by his son, Mark. Bill will then make brief comments before his prepared remarks are relayed by another son, John. In other words, Bill, from the years you spent with IUTA softball, let's think in these terms. If this were a double play combination in IUTA softball, it would be Deam to Deam to Deam. Mark, it's all yours.
Thank you, Dave. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to start off by congratulating all of you that are being inducted into this year's class of the Sidney City Schools Hall of Honor. Next, I would like to thank Jim Hall for nominating Dad and for the Hall of Honor Committee members for electing him. Dad was born in Sidney on August 22, 1922, the firstborn child to Emerson and Helen Deam. He graduated from Sidney High School in 1940. He had a younger sister, Jane, who graduated in 1941 and is now deceased, and has a brother, Jim, who graduated in 1947. He grew up at 733 St. Mary's Avenue. Dad was part of the American society that has become known as the greatest generation. He typifies those individuals who rose above the problems of the times and made a contribution to society that was unparalleled in its time and may never be duplicated. Dad served his country, came home, raised a family, and still dedicated himself to serving his community. Following a precedent set by his father, Emerson Deam, who served in World War I, Dad entered the U.S. Army in 1942. He was drafted by the Shelby County Draft Board, and his father was the chairman of the draft board at that time. I guess Grandpa had an ideal way of kicking his kids out of the nest. Dad was initially assigned to a combat engineer battalion, but when it was posted that the Army was looking for pilots, Dad thought it might be better to fly than to walk and volunteered for flight training and attended officers training school and was commissioned a second lieutenant and became a B-26 pilot. Dad flew 63 combat missions, mainly in support of General Patton, flew missions on D-Day and was forced to bail out on his 59th mission because of their plane running out of fuel and bad weather. That was also his practice jump. That was the first time he'd ever jumped out of a plane. He was awarded the Air Medal with 3 Oak Leaf Clusters, Air Medal with 2 Silver Leaf Clusters, and the Victory in Europe Medal. Dad was discharged in August of 1945 and married my mother, Mary Brockman, on January 18th, 1947. After fighting diabetes for over 40 years, Mom passed away May 4th, 2003. They were married for 56 years. My twin sister, Marcia Schaefer, and I were born in October 1947. A son, Tommy, was born in May 1956 and passed away at the age of 3. And a third son, John, who will be up here in a little bit, was born in October 1960. Now Dad has 4 grandchildren and 10 great-grandchildren. In the 1950s, Dad worked for Mack Truck as a personnel manager. In 1959, Mack closed the Sidney plant and was transferred to Allentown, Pennsylvania. We lived there until 1963 when his father passed away and his mother wanted him to move back to Sidney and take over Deam Insurance Agency that his father had started in 1925. Dad's brother Jim joined him in 1968. Dad retired April 29, 1988, and the family business was sold at that time. Dad has served his community in many ways, having served on the Sidney Zoning Board of Appeals for 25 years, 15 years as chairman, the IUDIS Club in many capacities, including president and coach, and inducted in the IUDIS Hall of Fame in 1999. The Rotary Club is president and Rotarian of the Year in 1988, Sidney High School Band and Orchestra Parents Association, and the Senior Swingers. For those of you that don't know, the Senior Swingers is a golf league. It plays on Monday morning at Shelby Oaks. In October 2000, Dad had a stroke to his optic nerve and in 1 week lost most of his vision. He has trouble recognizing people unless he recognizes the person's voice. For those of you that greet him in the gym following this ceremony, I ask that you please identify yourself so he knows who you are. He can read with the help of a video eye, but has not driven a car since 2000. He has many friends that take him places when Marcia, John, and I aren't available. Paul Workman picks him up every Monday and takes him to Rotary, except when he and Janice are traveling. Bob Birch or Errol Broud picks him up when Paul's out of town. Paul Sarver, Dick Ward, and Bill Rudy always make sure that Dad gets to and from the IUDIS meetings. Dad's brother Jim and friends John Richards and Frank Oakey also take him places, as do some other friends. Brother-in-laws Wayne and George Brockman get him to and from the Senior Swingers. I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of you for your help. It's really been appreciated. Dad is a lifetime member of the Sidney First United Methodist Church and has served on numerous committees and was also an usher for many years. Dad has unselfishly contributed to his country, his family, and has enriched the lives of all he has touched. He continues to be active in many organizations and serves his community in an unheralded fashion. He is an example of the type of individual that this country needs in order to spread the values on which this country was founded. The greatest generation is well represented by Bill Deam. It is indeed an honor for me to present to you my dad, Bill Deam.
By the way, Mark is 18 minutes older than Marcia. That was a surprise, too. I think that 9 out of 10 great-grandchildren are here tonight, ranging in age from 2 months to 16 years. And I want to thank the family and our friends for coming tonight. When you graduate in 1940, whether you use new math or old math, and I don't know what the difference is, That's 66 years ago, and what little I learned then, I probably have forgotten by now. But I'm not aware that I've ever, in school, ever received any academic awards of any kind. My priorities were somewhere besides studying, at least after school. I studied enough in school to get through, so anyway. I have lost a good bit of my sight. I did try to put some things together about some of the historic things that happened to the class of 1940 during the 12 years of school, and of which John's, I'm going to turn that over to him. I would like to very briefly tell you one experience I had in the military, and as Mark mentioned, when I was in the combat engineers for 3 months, and see all these planes flying around, that looked like an easier life than the combat engineers. And when the opportunity presented itself to transfer to pilot training, I did that. And when we finished pre-flight, 2 months of pre-flight down Maxwell Field, Montgomery, Alabama, they shipped us up to, some of us, up to Helena, Arkansas, which is about 50 miles downstream from Memphis on the west bank of the Mississippi River. The very first day, went up to start primary training in a PT-19. It was two cockpits, front and back, and the instructor sat in the back. They were civilian instructors in primary, military instructors from basic and advanced. But the very first day up, hadn't even touched the stick or the pedals, and the instructor sat in the back. No radio, but he did have a mouthpiece with some hose that you plugged in, and you could hear him okay, and he gave you instructions usually based on yes or no. So you shake your head yes or no. You didn't want to have too many no's. And we were probably a couple thousand feet, I don't know how high we were, above the Mississippi River. And he asked me if my seatbelt was secured. As far as I knew, it was secured. And at that point, he rolled the thing over upside down, and we were hanging by our seatbelts over the Mississippi River. I've always been a firm believer of seatbelts from that point on. that was at that point in time, I wasn't sure that I made a very smart move at jumping from had my feet on the ground in the combat engineers to the pilot training program. But things went better after that. But that was an experience. A little, couple anxious moments there. But he thought it was okay. I wasn't too thrilled about it. So anyway, I put a few things together that may be of interest to you. Again, I want to thank the Hall of Honor Committee and Dave Ross and all our friends and family, and thank you very much. John?
All right. Good job, Dad. Hope you're all fans of Speedy Gonzalez, because I'm going to have to zip through this. We have a time limit, and I'm going to have to get it done. First of all, I'd like to thank Dad, tell Dad just how proud we are of him, and to personally thank him for giving me a good work ethic, for teaching me what's right and what's wrong, for helping me to shape my sense of humor, and most importantly of all, I think, the recessive gene for the male pattern baldness. Thanks, Dad. growing up, I've frequently been told I look a lot like Dad and sound like him, so it's my honor to read his Hall of Honor presentation tonight. June 6, 1940, 121 seniors graduated from the old Sidney High School auditorium. Had someone told me at this time that in April of 2006 I would again be in the Sidney High School stage to be inducted into the City Schools Hall of Honor, I would have suggested that they were out in the heat too long. I do not remember of ever achieving any academic awards, and my only claim to fame was playing trumpet 6 years in the band and being manager of the basketball team my sophomore, junior, and senior years. I would like to thank Dave Ross, his Hall of Honor committee, for my election into the Hall of Honor class of 2006. I would also like to congratulate Jim and Doris, Harry, and Larry for also being elected to the 2006 Hall of Honor. In addition, I would like to thank Jim Hall and Mark for preparing and submitting an application for consideration. I would also like to thank Bill Rudy on behalf of the IUDIS Club and Steve Shukin on behalf of the Rotary Club for their supplemental input to the application. Schools were quite different back in the 1920s and 30s. They did not have computers, calculators, guidance counselors, or parking lots full of automobiles, but we did have a courtyard full of bicycle racks. Since we had no school bus service inside the corporation, you basically had two ways of getting to school, walk or ride a bike. We had no cafeteria, but we did have the Amos and Andy trimmed in orange and black. We had an hour for lunch, and if you lived close enough, you could go home for lunch. School staffs were considerably different than now. For instance, Mr. O.R. Finley was the principal of the high school, and his staff consisted of one secretary and one assistant, Miss Frances Good. Mr. Finley would go to the typing and shorthand class for help as needed, kind of an on-the-job training program. In addition to being principal, Mr. Finley also taught two or three classes in physics every day, and Mrs. Good, whose title I think was Dean of Girls, taught two or three classes of French every day. The class of 1940, as well as other classes in that time period, had some unique happenings throughout the 12 years of school. In 1929, when we were second graders, the stock market crashed. The economy hit rock bottom, and we were instantly in a deep depression. Many of our school years were during the depression, and this meant that if you had a hole in your sock, you didn't throw them away and buy a new pair. You gave them to your mother, who would put a block of wood inside the sock to better expose the hole so that she could darn the hole shut and give them back to you, and they were good for another 100 miles. 1937 was an exciting year when we were freshmen. It started off one March morning, and we were in algebra class on the third floor, southwest corner of the building, when we had an earthquake. It probably lasted 20 or 30 seconds, and the teacher was Mr. Davis, who, as I remember, was very disturbed. When he regained his composure, his only comment was, "While the building was shaking and the windows were rattling, every bad thing I ever did went through my mind." In 37, Sidney High School was in sports league with six other schools, better known as the Miami Valley League, or the MVL. Schools were comprised of Xenia, Dayton Fairmont, Miamisburg, Piqua, Troy, Greenville, and of course, Sidney. All schools were fairly comparable in size, and that made a very competitive league. That year, Sidney won the MVL outright in football, basketball, track, and tennis. Sidney did not have a baseball team at that time, and no one had even heard of soccer. Sidney's basketball team lost to Hamilton in the Dayton District Finals by 4 points, and that game was played at the old Dayton Fairground Coliseum. Hamilton went on to win the state championship. The starting five included two brothers who still live in Sidney, Lloyd and Norris Cromus. The two other starters are both members of Sidney City Schools Hall of Honor, Roger Spreen and Ralph Monroe. The fifth member was Jerry Brown, who was an outstanding athlete and was a center around 6'1". Unfortunately, Jerry developed some type of cancer while serving in the military and died at the age of 22. The doubles tennis team consisted of Norris Cromus and Roger Spreen. They played against Dayton Oakwood in the state finals and unfortunately lost. After graduation, I went to work at Monarch Machine. I worked third shift, 7 nights a week. It was hard work, and I realized then that I didn't really want to work in a factory setting the rest of my life. I don't believe too many of us were concerned about Hitler's rampage across Europe, as it was an Atlantic ocean away. However, December 7th, 1941, when Pearl Harbor was attacked, that got everyone's attention, and practically every male in the class of 1940, except those that had a critical job or a physical impairment, ended up in some branch of the military. Eight from our class left on October 15th, 1942, including Dave's dad, Bill Ross, along with 64 other Shelby Countyans. Upon my return from the service, I worked for approximately 4 years at Dunson Supply and then went to work at Montgomery Ward here in Sidney as a department manager of the auto and hardware departments. In 57, I took a position with Mack Truck as personnel manager. During those years, I joined the IUTAS Club and spent a number of years coaching the youth softball program. I've been active in the IUTAS Club for approximately 55 years. Upon returning from Pennsylvania, I remained active in IUTAS, joined the Rotary Club, and served 25 years on the Sidney Zoning Board of Appeals. I've been a lifelong member of the Sidney First United Methodist Church. I've enjoyed serving my community, and guess I probably got inspired to do so by my father, Emerson Deam, who served his country in World War I, served as mayor of Sidney on two different occasions, was chairman of the Shelby County Draft Board during World War II, and served as commander of the American Legion. I retired in 1988. Mary and I were fortunate to have been able to travel before and after our retirement, and have also enjoyed going fishing, golfing, and playing cards. We've been blessed with a wonderful family and many wonderful friends throughout the years. In closing, I'd like to thank my late wife, Mary, for 56 wonderful years of marriage. I wish she could have been here with me tonight. I'd also like to thank my children, Mark and his wife, Joyce, Marcia, and her husband, Dan, and John, my brother, Jim, and his wife, Nancy, my grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and other relatives and good friends for sharing this special evening with me. I'd also like to again thank everyone involved for this wonderful experience of being inducted into the Sidney City Schools Hall of Honor. Thank you.
I think I'll clarify one thing. Playing in the band for 6 years doesn't mean it took 6 years to get through high school. The band was so small then, when you got down to the seventh grade, and when the seventh and the eighth grade were both attached to the high school, you were eligible in the seventh grade to start playing the band. So it didn't take 6 years to get through high school.
Bill, more than that 6 years in the band, I'm concerned about the senior swingers, and I'm worried that one of these Monday mornings I'll find you on the Jerry Springer show. I don't think so either. I think I know better than that. Brett Bickle, who was recognized earlier from our committee, also serves as advisor to the Sidney High School Student Council, which has assisted very ably here this evening. The group also administers the Freedom Rock Veterans Display. It's behind the high school near the baseball diamond. This was established last spring, the brainchild of the graduating class of 1971, a year ahead of my group. The Freedom Rock salutes Sidney High School alumni for their military service. 90 new bricks were just added this week. It's impressive, it's appropriate. Brett will be at the reception across the hall this evening. He'll be glad to talk to you about this project. He has further information available. Our next recipient has been on this stage many times for this very event. Our longtime committee chairman, Harry Faulkner, will be presented by his son, Doug Faulkner.
Thank you. Juicy fruit gum. Peanut butter on crackers. Sports of any kind, especially those involving Sidney High School or Ohio Wesleyan University. Recalling stories or events that occurred over the last 50 years, work, practicing law, helping others, and community involvement. These are some of the things that our next recipient, Harry Faulkner, enjoys. In preparation for this evening, I asked a number of people to describe how Dad has influenced them. A couple of themes emerged. Community service. Harry graduated from Ohio Wesleyan University, attended Ohio Northern University for law school, served as assistant prosecutor in Springfield, and then migrated back to Sidney to practice law. Since his return, he has thrived in various roles in the city and Shelby County area. Mark Wells provided these comments about Harry's community service. As long as I have known him, he has been a champion for the growth and economic well-being of his beloved hometown, Sidney, Shelby County, Ohio. For 35 years, Harry has been the president of the Community Improvement Corporation of Sidney, which was formed in 1967. The group unites city and county governments with the private sector through the Chamber of Commerce to advance, encourage, promote the industrial, economic, commercial, and civic development of the city and surrounding areas in Shelby County. Through Harry's dedicated leadership, the CIC has been the motivational force for the Western Ohio Development Council, whose efforts since 1983 are evidenced by the continuing robust economic prosperity of this community. Harry has served on the WODUC board since its beginning and in recent years as its chairman. Harry is truly what is classified, or Harry is truly what classical economists refer to as, quote, very defining entrepreneur in energizing local economic development. He is a tireless worker for the continued prosperity of this part of Ohio, and inducting him into the Hall of Honor is a tribute well deserved. He serves on the following boards: the Edison State Community College Foundation, the Dorothy Love Retirement Community, the People's Federal Savings and Loan Association, and the local library. The second theme that has emerged about Harry is his passion for sports. Harry has a real love of sports, which he learned naturally. He is the son of Walter and Catherine Faulkner. He has two younger brothers, Dick and Bill. He fondly describes stories of Grandma Faulkner pole vaulting in high school. She supported the boys in all their endeavors and also participated with them and maybe a little better than them. Dad grew up on South Main Street and spent hours playing basketball in his driveway, which he now affectionately refers to as Madison Square Garage. He also enjoys hours of fun at the local park with his friends, who call themselves the Burger Park Gang. At Ohio Wesleyan, Harry played football for 4 years and lettered three. Lori, Julie, and I spent many hours participating in and watching sports. From very young ages, we played catch in the yard or kickball in the driveway. Dad coached IU to softball for many years and helped me develop my tennis skills. We played endless hours of basketball and horse on our driveway basketball court. Harry is an avid fan of the professional sports teams, and we loved heading to Cincinnati for Reds or Bengals games. Today, he enjoys visiting me and my family in Fort Lauderdale and attending Miami Heat games. He fondly refers to himself as Ohio's greatest Miami Heat fan. On weekends during football and basketball season, you'll frequently find him at an Ohio Wesleyan University sporting event. In addition to community service and sports, Harry is devoted to work and his knowledge. He is beginning his fifth decade as a local attorney. He takes pride in being associated with his partners and his office staff. He has a fantastic memory and quotes facts and figures and remembers stories from his youth and college as if it were yesterday. He has an uncanny ability to remember events, people, places, even the weather in the most amazing detail. Pat Milligan describes Harry as a human Google when it comes to sports trivia. Growing up, Dad focused on our education and encouraged us. He was fond of the English language and often corrected our grammar. In fact, we were often embarrassed when he corrected our friends' grammar. Today, we appreciate his effort and benefit from them. We hope to pass these skills and other life lessons on to our families. Lori and her husband, Kelly, live in Dallas and have an 18-month-old son, Grant. Julie and her husband, Evan, also live in Dallas and have two children, 2-year-old Lily and 10-month-old Luke. My wife, Amy, and I live in Fort Lauderdale with our 18-month-old daughter, Alexandra. We are anxiously awaiting the arrival of another baby girl in early June. For his leadership, community service, professional accomplishments, I am pleased to introduce this year's nominee, Harry Faulkner.
Thank you very much, Doug. That was very, very touching. And the juicy fruit is still a part of my life, I want you to know. Mr. Chairman, members of the Hall of Honor Committee, Dr. Trigo, fellow inductees and friends, I am very pleased and honored to be inducted into the 2006 class of the Sidney City Schools Hall of Honor. I received many cards and many best wishes as I walked the streets of town, and the most interesting one, however, was a fellow who said, Harry, you know, it's great that you're going into the Hall of Honor. The only thing that I could imagine it would be any better would be to speak at the commencement of your high school that you graduated from. So Dr. Trigo, I just want you to know I'm available. And Dr. Trigo, I'm also inexpensive, and any time you have an attorney that says he's inexpensive, you better listen up. Seriously, to join the Hall of Honor is a great privilege, and I am humbled to join many of the local folks, the names that you heard this evening, Oliver Amos, Bill Amos, goodness sakes, Bill Ross, and so many other people that were hallowed names in our home. And on the world stage, Dr. Paul Lauterbur, who was one of the inventors of the MRI, and Dr. Clyde Fisher, who helped create the Hayden Planetarium. And the pictures that showed up just a little while ago, there was a picture of me holding a basketball, sort of like so. Now that's really funny because I was on the basketball team all the way through high school. I really shouldn't have been when I was a senior. If I scored 10 points, it would be a miracle. And I actually had my own rooting section. Down at the University of Cincinnati, there was a chap from Crispus Attucks in Indianapolis by the name of Oscar Robertson, and he was called the Big O. At Sidney High School, I was called the Big H. I had my own rooting section, and it was Jerry McCoy and Dave Neer and some other guys that thought that was just great sport. Dr. Carl Wiley, who I was surprised to see here this evening, was a pastor for many years at the First Methodist Church in Sidney, always had 3 points in his sermon. And I'm going to follow that very good example and hope that I don't run out of time and carry forward on the 3 points. The three topics basically are thanks and acknowledgments to family and friends, a very few experiences in community activities starting in 1972 and 1973, fast-forwarding that up to 1983, fast-forwarding then to 1984 when we worked on the Honda projects. The final feature of this is one that I have denominated as lessons I have learned in life in 65 years and 28 days on this earth. And quoting Dr. Ross Wilhide, who was at the Methodist Church in our youth, used to say, "When your yesterdays outnumber your tomorrows," and then he'd give you one right square in the nose, "I've got a few that probably aren't nearly as powerful as what he gave us, but nevertheless, there's some wisdom there, a few original quotes, and a couple of other quotes as well." Being a good little Methodist boy, and you know we have a few Methodists here and a couple out in the audience here and there, I thought I'd start with a little prayer I came across. It was kind of cute. And it goes, "Dear Lord, so far today, Lord, I've done all right. I haven't gossiped. I haven't lost my temper. Haven't been greedy, grumpy, nasty, selfish, or overindulgent. I'm very thankful for that. But in a few minutes, Lord, I'm going to get out of bed. And from then on, I'm probably going to need a lot more help. I want to preface my family and friends' comments by acknowledging the wonderful remarks that Doug presented to you this evening and the fact that not only he, but his two sisters, Lori and Julie, are in the audience. These are very, very busy people with small children and take the time out to come to be part of this celebration tonight for me is very, very touching. I could tell vignettes about each of you, but my time's running fast and I got so many things I need to say and I hope I hope I can get through them. But I sincerely appreciate your abundant kindnesses in being here. To Bonnie, I want to thank her for her kindnesses not only to me, but also to my mother, to my children, and to my extended family. In the audience is Bonnie's son, Brian. Bonnie has been wonderful to Bonnie, and his maternal and paternal grandparents' health is shrinking, and Brian has been a wonderful grandson in trying to embrace them in some very tough times. My mother, Catherine Faulkner, the old pole vaulter, the basketball shooter, was a wonderful influence in my life, and I hope her hearing aid's turned up so she gets some of this. But if it isn't, you know, we'll show it to her again. Mom said to me on many occasions, "You know, I wish you'd get off that committee so that maybe they'd get you in there before I leave this life." Well, Mom, baby, we made it. You know, tonight I'm number 79 and we're here. So thanks. I have two brothers. My brother Dick, I saw him in a few minutes ago. He's a retired high school principal from King's High School in Cincinnati. And last year got another master's degree and is going to serve as a counselor. And kids are very fortunate to have Dick with his insight, character, strength, and size. He was the big one. He was the tough one. Bill, on the other hand, was the debater. He's the optometrist in Anchorage, Alaska. And he's the one that had all the fun. My Aunt Margaret was a music teacher in the school. She was a graduate of the conservatory in Cincinnati and gave operettas every year, went to New York every summer to see what plays were new and what she could present in the community. My grandfather, for whom I'm named, was the first president of the Sidney Civic Association. He was president of the school board, and when Dean Snyder was inducted in the first class, I said, "I'm Harry Faulkner." He said, "Harry Faulkner, Harry Faulkner hired me." So Grandpa was president of the school board at that time. He was also, interestingly, president of the Harding Coolidge Club and was the first president of the Sidney Civic Association, which was a predecessor of the Chamber of Commerce. My Uncle Tom was a very talented vocalist, and mark your calendar, he'll be 100 years old on November 15 of this year, so please send him a card. I've waited till last to mention my father, because Dad was a man of not a lot of words, but by his actions you knew where you stood. He was a 33rd degree Mason. He was lay leader at the Methodist Church, a Sunday school superintendent. He actually preached a couple of sermons, and in the fall of 59, I came back to hear him preach. And son of a gun, people said afterwards, "Maybe you missed your calling, Pete. Maybe you should have been a pastor." From my parents and family, I was never pushed. I was never pushed to achieve, to do anything particularly, but rather quietly encouraged. And quite honestly, with that legacy, with that background, I wanted to please them. And I wanted to make them proud. I've had many, many positive influences in my life, and time isn't going to permit me to hit all of those. But just to say very quickly, Pat Milligan, Mark Wells, Paul Gahagan, Emerson Wagner, Tom Shoemaker for so many years, the attorneys in our law firm that have just been wonderful, wonderful friends and great practitioners and great community servants, from Ohio Wesleyan, John Kircher, Grant McLennan, Bob Cook, and Dale Bruce, just wonderful, wonderful friends. From the teacher's side, the late Vera Gann, Bernice Berry Blake, Dora Grau, Ruth Wyatt, Frances Sargent, world history teacher, wonderful lady. Glenna Foote, I was actually on her scholarship team to Miami University, and Jean Blest, who was an English teacher, and I was on her annual staff. The all-star, of course, is Cheryl Edler. Mr. Edler has been a fast family friend, and I was in his first homeroom just 50 short years ago when he and Lois showed up from Marshall University. It has been just a treasure in my life to have known Mr. Edler as I have, and I just welcome any time spent with him. If you note in the program, there's a blurb about things that I like to talk about, which include the class of 59, Ohio Wesleyan University, and growing up in the south end of Sydney in the 50s. Now, the class of 59 is really done for Mr. Edler because we were freshmen in the fall of 1959 when he came, so he sort of grew up with us. And I always was happy to say to him, "Now, look out, Mr. Edler, the class of 1959 is taking over the world." And he'd just sort of shake his head and laugh and smile, but I would come back and say, "Well, Phil Valentine is on the school board. Steve Hubbell's county engineer. John Blake is a banker extraordinaire. Tom Seaving is on the board at Edison Community College. Lou Blackard is a school superintendent. Tom Amos, a radiologist in Dayton. Jim Foote owns Buck's Limo. And Jim Russell is a professor of curriculum at Purdue University." So how in the world could you argue with that? Right, Mr. Edler? You couldn't do it. I certainly want to acknowledge, and I've got to watch my time here, the wonderful influences that I had at the Methodist Church. Russ Bunker, Vern Davis, and Lefty Bauer were all my Sunday school teachers. We had great softball teams, and we had just a hoot playing a lot of ball. And so, believe it or not, Saturday night, you know, we'd go to Cusson Border Field and play softball. Acknowledge also the officers, the board, and employees at People's Federal who have been absolutely so wonderful. Experiences in the community. I got started, I lost for prosecutor in 1972. Dick Pope, who was president of Stolle in about 1973, thought I ought to run for the chamber board. Not only did I run, but I was elected, and lo and behold, I became second vice president, and what did I know about being president of the chamber? Absolutely nothing. But we persevered that. In 1983, the economic climate of the community wasn't very doggone good. We had about an 18% unemployment rate, and Mark Wells had taken early retirement at the suggestion of the powers that be at the Dayton Power and Light Company. And Tom Given and Herb Slater and Dan Francis, perhaps John Garmhausen, also helped hire Mark to an economic development survey for the city of Sydney. With an 18% unemployment rate, we needed to do something. That group was created as known as the West Ohio Development Council. Today, we believe that we have helped create 15,000 to 17,000 job opportunities in Shelby County. In 1984, I was privileged to work with Honda of America Manufacturing in our location of the Anna Engine Plant. I worked with Susan Inslee, the attorney from Bell Fountain, who was going to be here today but had to go to a retreat in Normandy. She said, "Faulkner, I'll be 40,000 feet over the ocean when this occurs, but I was going to be here if it weren't for that." So I guess I'd rather go to Normandy, perhaps, than be here. I worked with her, and we went door to door. We'd start in the morning, and we'd go late at night. There was one night it snowed, and she came home and spent the night in Laurie's bed. The interesting part of it was that the bigger it became, the more I became aware of the tremendous impact that this was going to have on our community. One of my partners, Jim Schenck, worked with Emerson Wagner and all the real estate sides of it, and it was just probably the singularly most meaningful portion of my work. Who would think from 1984 to today, we have 2,800 employees at the Anna Engine Plant, 505 acres, as Harold Shuey said, they didn't buy that ground, Harry, to plant soybeans. Now that Dave is standing up, I know that I have to sit down. You see, Mama didn't raise a dummy, and we kind of know, because Dave's a lot bigger than I am, in case you hadn't noticed. But I want to wrap up with another quote that I came across that I think is absolutely magnificent. It's supposedly a Chinese proverb, and it says the following: if you want to be happy for an hour, take a nap. If you want to be happy for a day, go fishing. If you want to be happy for a week, take a vacation. If you want to be happy for a month, get married. If you want to be happy, doesn't apply to you, Bonnie. if you want to be happy for a year, inherit great wealth. But this is the clincher, folks. But if you want to be happy for a lifetime, help others. I'm honored to be selected for this great honor this evening. I appreciate greatly all of you being here, and particularly the kind words from Doug and the fact that Lori and Julie were able to be here. Thank you very much, and God bless you.
Thanks, Harry. When I joined this committee, Harry was the chairman, and it didn't take me long to figure when I looked at our schedule of meetings that one was never held on the night that Ohio Wesleyan had a home basketball game. That didn't take long to figure at all. And since I go with Harry once in a while on those now that I'm chairman, that same thing still somewhat takes place. When you leave here this evening, please take with you a copy of our printed program. Take a look at all 80 members of the Hall of Honor. Reflect on their accomplishments. Some excelled outside of Sidney. Some stayed right here and made a difference. Each has a unique story. These people make me proud to be affiliated with the Sidney City Schools. I hope you feel the same way. Pages 24 and 25 of the program thank those who have financially supported the Hall of Honor and our efforts. We thank them and hope to see an expanded list in future years. Page 27 details our nomination process and what you can do to help. Our work begins with quality nominations. Take a program home, keep it handy. Look at it once in a while. Help all of us enhance this positive activity. Though I grew up in Sidney and still reside in the immediate area, most Hall of Honor ceremonies afford me the opportunity to meet one of the inductees for the very first time. Yesterday, I finally got to meet Larry Lorton and witness his message to the students in the Opportunity School here at Sidney High School. It was both enjoyable and inspiring. Great way to meet a guy for the first time. Larry, our other three inductees, and 2002 member Nancy Olson all have met with current students in various forums over the past day and a half. We thank all five of them for helping to inspire our current students consistent with our mission statement. Now back to Larry Lorton. He'll be introduced by his aunt, Dorothy Locker. She was up here just 2 years ago on behalf of her son. Aunt Dorothy, it's all yours.
Good evening. This is a very special night for the inductees, families, friends, and acquaintances. But for the recipient, Dr. Larry Lorton, it is truly a privilege to have been chosen by the committee to receive the prestigious honor of being inducted into the Sidney City Schools Hall of Honor. His parents are both deceased, but I'm sure they're here with him tonight and saying we're very proud of you and of a job well done. Larry attended Sidney City Schools, graduated in 1956, continued his education at Miami University, receiving a Bachelor of Science degree in education. He also received a Master of Science and a PhD from the University of Akron. His accomplishments are numerous. He served as superintendent of schools in two of the largest districts in Maryland, one of the largest in the United States with an enrollment of 70,000 students. The most important goal in his career has been to improve the education system, not only for the children, but for the enhancement of the career of the teachers and his other co-workers. The quote, "No child left behind," could have been his motto throughout his time with the schools. A very special part of his life is his family. His wife, Diane, son, Mark, daughter and son-in-law, Beth and Paul Wagner, and their three beautiful, active little children, Zachary, Nicholas, and Emma, and two stepsons, Andrew and Ryan. Sports is his specialty. Played football in high school, coached football at Massillon High School and at Kent State University. Other sports that he has participated in include golf, distance running, sailing, scuba diving, also backpacked across Europe for several weeks. These are just a few of the many of his activities. And I just heard last evening that he also did a lot of singing sometime. Sometime between all of his activities, he picked up carpentry. He and his wife built their very large, beautiful home in Maryland, and he seems to look for things to remodel. and I would call this a man of many hats. I could and would very much like to tell you a little bit about him as a youth, but I was threatened, so I am sure he would prefer that I not discuss that at this time. So I'll be on my best behavior, and I would like, instead, to introduce you to Dr. Larry Lorton.
Folks, I just dodged a bullet.
Superintendent Trigo told us earlier that he'd gotten some good advice from his father. I got some good advice from my father as well, and he told me to never allow yourself to be caught in a position of being the last speaker before dessert. I had the opportunity to have a nice chat with Bill Deam this morning, and Dave's probably going to hold this time against me, but I'm going to tell you a story anyway. Two of my very, very best friends forever are Butch and Jan Sparks, and everybody knows that Butch's dad was a physician throughout his entire lifetime here in Sydney. Butch's dad, Doc Sparks, delivered Bill's children. And when the first time this happened, Bill was anxiously waiting, and pretty soon, you know, Doc Sparks came through the door and said, "Bill, do you want a boy or a girl?" Bill says, "I don't care." And Doc Sparks said, "It's a good thing, because you got one of each." I want to thank you all for coming tonight, and I want to thank Lou Blackford for spearheading my nomination. And I hope that each of you will have a chance to meet my family that's here, especially my wife, the best thing that's ever happened to me and the love of my life. My children, we had a family dispute. I persuaded my son Mark and Beth, who had the misfortune of having me as a father for their growing up years, but I persuaded them to stay home. Mark, because he's trying to run a new business he just started, a styling salon, and it needs him. And Beth, because of those three little children, Zachary, Nicholas, and Emma. In 1705, about a century before this nation was born, on the occasion of his knighthood by Queen Anne, Isaac Newton, in reference to the great scientist before him, remarked, "If I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants." Newton's simple insight rings true for us all. Whatever successes any of us achieve, whether large or small, noted or not, demand that we acknowledge that there is little we do without the assistance and support of others. I am among those blessed souls whose journey has been continually exciting, challenging, and immensely rewarding. It's been a ride not anticipated or necessarily planned, not marked by childhood or teenage goals or "when I grow up, I want to be's." I am critically aware that I have had enormous help every step along the way. I can tell you, for example, with the clarity as if it happened this morning rather than in May of 1963 at the end of my first year of teaching. My principal, Walter Keller, a man I adored, told me he was transferring to Jones Junior High School, one of three in Maslin, overwhelmingly poor, half the size of the other two, and he wanted me to go with him. I asked why he was going, and I asked why me. And like the Apostle Paul's epiphany on the road to Damascus, I encountered my own burning bush in the next moment when Mr. Keller replied, "Because the kids need us." Mr. Keller truly was a giant in my life. I got to Maslin from Miami University to begin with because they needed a math teacher and a football coach. I truly believe to this day that I may have been the only candidate in the entire state who filled both qualifications. The superintendent at the time, John Ellis, who later became the Deputy Commissioner of Education in the Jimmy Carter administration, interviewed me for about 20 minutes. The head football coach interviewed me for over 2 hours. They hired me. Giants in my life. I got to Kent State to coach football 2 years later because my head coach at Massillon, Leo Strang, became the head coach at Kent and took me with him. I got to Goodyear because my Sunday school teacher at the First Methodist Church in Massillon was the vice president of personnel and convinced me to make the move. Giants in my life. I got to the Akron City Schools because the newly appointed superintendent from Jefferson County, Kentucky, was in a graduate research class I was teaching at the University of Akron on the use of statistical methods to measure program effectiveness. He created a job for me to do just that, a giant in my life. I got to Warren in charge of curriculum and research because the newly promoted superintendent turned out to be a friend I made on the track. We ran every day at noon in graduate school. He's a giant in my life. And so it was with all but two positions I held over my entire career. But I have to tell you that there was a moment when I thought my career was over before I really began. I did my student teaching here in Sydney under Luther Folk. Luther was old school. Didn't make any difference what my supervising teachers from Miami wanted. I was going to teach when Luther was ready. So I sat in the back of the room for nearly 9 weeks when the appointed day came. I want to tell you, I had 9 weeks to prepare that lesson. I had the best lesson plan in algebra ever known to mankind. And so on that day, he started off, he introduced me. I went up, laid my books on the table, and my materials, I mean, on the table, turned around, started to address the class, and there were tittering and some giggling, and I knew immediately what was wrong. My fly was wide open. But improvise as good teachers do, we resolved that one. I relate these stories to reiterate Newton's truism. I have had lots of help and support, but these vignettes also capture a second truth regarding my personal journey. None of it would have been possible had I not gone to college. For most, college in the early 50s, shortly after the war, tended to be a family thing, not something lots of people did. The GI Bill made college possible for thousands of returning servicemen, but in the early 50s, their children were still 10 years away from that tradition. In my immediate family, no one had ever gone to college before. My parents, and we forget this, but my parents, like nearly three-fourths of pre-war teens, dropped out of school. They knew what they wanted for me, but like me, they had no clue what it took to make it happen. They worked hard. Dad is a laborer, a molder at various foundries. Mom became the pie baker at the spot with the intent to help me financially, though the pies became more famous than the pie maker. And what she earned barely made a dent. But I learned from my dad. I learned from Dorothy's husband, my Uncle Bob, though I'm not sure when it was I ever formally acknowledged it. But I did learn a work ethic which has followed me throughout my life. But it was my friends that I grew up with in high school that I owe an enormous debt. I began to learn to compete from John King, and Dwight Wilgus, and Orrin Tucker, and Jerry Cable, Gary Paul, and the Spangler brothers. I signed up for what was then called the college prep program in high school, the right courses in order to get into college, because that's what my friends did. Butch Sparks mostly, but John Amos and Tom Hughes and Judy Brown Bemis and many others. Giants in my life. I got my first full-time job at 14 when the late Jerry Stump asked me if I wanted to replace him at Doc Clayton's farm just west of town on 47. I got my first meaningful job because Butch Sparks came by to tell me the new Sydney swimming pool needed a lifeguard and he recommended me. Did I want it? Harry Faulkner reinforced a lesson in hustle in a moment he and I talked about this morning. We happened to run into one another out on the job site when the Interstate 75 was being built, and he mentioned in passing he was going to report to the field office next morning before 6 o'clock, before the superintendent arrived. I decided to be there too. So every morning at dawn, the first two people the superintendent saw when he came on the job was Harry and me, asking him if he had jobs yet. What I remember was about the third day, he asked how long we intended to be there when he showed up for work. We told him we were going to be there until he hired us. We started the next day. Before summer was done, miracle of miracles, I had my tuition money for Miami. John Amos, Lou Blackford, Doug Marker, I always suspected, though they never said and I never asked, were instrumental in my acquiring certain jobs at the fraternity house that paid for my meals. All giants in my life. And so the great ride my life has been one of opportunity and possibility made available by example in the hands of others. In closing, I am only too keenly aware that there is nothing I can do to adequately repay my giants for their support and guidance and friendship, save to publicly acknowledge them from this podium. Nor can I adequately express what is in my heart with you here assembled and my family and the committee that made this event possible. Yes, I stand here with great pride that I am taking a seat on the bench behind the stars that have preceded me on this stage or should have been here to receive what they so richly deserve. But I stand here also in unshakable humility. In this particular small Midwestern town, at this particular place, in this particular moment, because I've been carried here on the shoulders of giants, I have nothing more to say to you or give to you in return than my deepest, warmest, and most profound thank you.
We couldn't have started better. We couldn't have finished better. What came in between was also great. Tonight, the Sidney City Schools Hall of Honor has increased its membership from 76 to 80. Let's hear it again for Jim and Doris Abbott, Bill Deam, Harry Faulkner, and Larry Lorton, the class of 06. Let's again bring the lights up. The chamber choir will lead the recessional singing of the Sidney High School alma mater. You'll find that now you can't get out of this by saying you don't know the words because they're inside your front cover. And anybody who didn't get a copy on the way in will see that you get one. I'll lead the onstage group through the crowd and across the hall to the reception. When the singing concludes, our audience will file into the auditorium. The hallway plaques and the permanent display will already be unveiled as you pass. Enter the gym quickly for group photo opportunities with the recipients and their plaques in an organized setting. Then each recipient will head to his own reception table to meet and greet all of you. That's a major reason why we're here. Again, please enter the gym quickly after the singing. Our reception is there, not in the hallway. We have refreshments and hope you'll remain for a while to honor the class of 2006 of the Sidney City Schools Hall of Honor. Thanks for being here. One more time, Amanda and the Chamber Choir. Please rise.